Values play a very important role in painting. Whether you're copying masterpieces or creating your own original art, being correct with the values is essential. So to create correct values, you have to be able to judge them. And that requires practice, of course. Besides practice, there is a tool that we can create that can be incredibly useful to determine the values. So today I will show you how to make your own value scale or value checker that can be used to improve your art. You will need the following materials for the value scale. A piece of canvas, approximately 15 inches long and 4 or 5 inches wide, or even 3 is fine. A ruler, scissors, gamsol or odorless mineral spirits to clean the brush, 2 paint colors, black and white, preferably titanium white and ivory black, a palette knife, a small brush, could be 2 to size 6, a pencil, and finally a palette that you can use to mix the colors. So the first step will be to create our chart. Oh, and one more tool that I almost forgot, and it's important. It's a hole puncher, because we're gonna create small holes on our value scale. So step one is we're going to create our chart. So we need to draw it first. And I'm going to draw 9 approximately 1.5 by 1.5 squares. And you can make it a little bigger or smaller, whatever you prefer. So I'm just going to make marks every 1.5 inches. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. And I need to measure the 1.5 down from the line all the way, so we get a straight line. And then just create those little squares. If they're not perfectly square, that's fine. You can also create 2 value scales, one that you're going to leave as one continuous string, and the other one, which I will demonstrate today, is where I'm going to cut this into individual pieces and use them such. So now that I have my little squares, I'm going to use my hole puncher and punch holes into each one of them, and for that I need to cut this canvas a little bit smaller so I can actually reach in where the square is. So hopefully this is enough. Yes, but not exactly. So it looks like, because my hole puncher is relatively short, I need to cut. Actually, I will cut right on the edge of the squares. That's probably the easiest and smartest way to do it. And I will just leave a little tab on the opposite side of each, so it's easier to hold it. Of course, it's not something that's necessary, and you might decide that you just want to cut both sides tight. So now I have enough room, and I want to approximate it somewhere in the middle. And that's all. Now that I prepared my canvas, I will start to mix each value for my value scale. So for that, what I need is to put my paint on the palette and mix the values. So I start with white on one end, and I won't close it because I probably still going to need it, and then black on the other end. Oops, and of course accidents like this happen. And now I'm going to create my first value, which is going to be my middle value, where I mix together the white and the black. Now, one rule of thumb in color mixing and value mixing is to start with the light color and add the darker to it. So I'm going to start with white, and I'm going to add, and I will place it here in the center of my palette to make it easier. And I will add the black to it. Rather start with a little bit of less black than too much right off the bat. What you'd like to, or what you should look for, is a neutral mid-tone gray that is not too dark and not too light. And this is going to be my middle value. So now I'm going to take a little bit of this, place it on the left and right of this gray. So on one side, I'm going to darken it by adding a little bit more black. And these steps are very subtle, meaning you don't want to add too much black right away, because then you're going to have too much contrast between the values, and we want subtlety in the steps. And on the other side, I will add some white to my mixture. And again, it's very subtle. It's just a little bit lighter than my middle value. Now, in order to get darker, I'm gonna take some of this again, place it next to my mixture, and do the same thing with this one, place it next to that. And this time, not like I did before, I take the white and I add the gray to the white. As I mentioned, it's usually a better way to approach mixing values and colors where you add the darker to the light, which I just skipped before. So again, subtle step. It's not strikingly lighter, just a little bit lighter. And I will do the same thing on the right here with the dark. I will just add a small amount to make it a little bit darker, and this is probably too much due to the quantity here. And yes, I feel that I made this a little bit too dark, probably. Maybe not. And again, take white. And this step is going to be the last one on the light side. And I will only take a small amount to create my light value that's just a hint darker than bright white or pure white. When I lift up the palette, you might be able to see it a little better this way. And one more step on the right for the dark. So again, I take away a bit of this, take a little bit of dark, mix the two together. A little bit more. And I have 7 values so far. And of course we have that I mixed. And of course we have 8 as white and 9 as black. So this way we have a full range of values. Now if I take my black, pure black, and place it against this as my darkest value, you can see there is a pretty significant difference. So what I'd like to do is, instead of using pure black, I'm just gonna add a very faint amount, just a subtle hint of my lightest gray without making this black too light. So you can see it. Now I have a little bit of a better range here. Now, of course, it doesn't mean you couldn't have a black in your painting, and if you want to keep it just as dark, that's fine. Most of the time I mix my blacks, even in color. So in order to do that, I use crimson mixed with the ultramarine blue. And even though they look just as dark as black, there is a faint difference between the two, a very subtle one. As far as white goes, I will just keep it as white. So now I have the 9 values that I'm going to put on my value scale. And the process from here is very straightforward. I'm going to paint them, and you can paint it first, let it dry, and then cut them into pieces, or you can cut them ahead of time and then paint them afterwards. I think it's probably easier and more simple to paint them first, let it dry, and cut it into, if you want to cut it up at all, but it will be a little bit easier to use if you use it on a photograph, a reference photo, to have it in individual pieces. And I'm using a little bit of a solvent to dilute it. And a little bit more. And you can see my canvas is actually a little bit of an off-white because this is brighter. So next, I'm cleaning my brush. It is a very important step to clean your brush between each step, or if you use a palette knife, do that. So I'm wiping off the brush in a piece of paper towel and then rinse it in my solvent, which is in my container. And then wipe it again. And there it goes, the next value. Again, I will clean my brush and go to the next value. It seems to be there is a pretty significant step here between the two. So I will just cheat a little bit and add a little bit more white to this. I do not want a huge value jump here. You could create any number of values you want. However, it is a good idea to keep your values limited in a painting. Therefore, I would say 9 would be a pretty balanced value scale. I would not recommend to go higher than that. You could do less, but not really much more than that, because that will get too confusing. Again, I will lighten it slightly. It's a little bit deceiving because right now I'm working on a white canvas, and that's one of the reasons I normally do not paint an actual painting on a white canvas, because it's so much harder to judge your values. And right now my mixtures are on a darker surface and my canvas is bright, so it will look significantly different and darker on the canvas than it was on the palette. So again, my middle value I will lighten slightly. I guess that's gonna be what's gonna happen to every one of my values. Next. Oh, sorry, and I of course need to clean my brush, especially here with the darker values. So we have 5 so far, and I have my 6th here. Again, I will sneak in a little light. And once you have your value scale, you can also use it to compare your colors and how dark or light the colors are in a painting, which is also very useful to create a convincing painting. And cleaning the brush. Again, I'm lightening slightly here. Don't want to be too dark compared to the one before. You want to cover the surface completely, especially around the hole. And then my final one, the darkest dark, again, I'm cleaning my brush. And that is my darkest dark. The final value on my value checker. The reason for the hole in the center is that it is easier to black out everything else and check exactly the spot you want to check on the picture. And there you have it. It's a 1 to 9 value string or value scale or value checker, whatever you want to call it. I will later, when it dries, cut it up into pieces. So just to have a better understanding how to use it, I will demonstrate it for you. So I move this. I have a book here with some black and white image in it. And actually I have a printout that I can use. So that's what I'll do. So there is a black and white printout of the painting I will going to paint. And so now I'm taking my value checker and go, for example, with number 2 and I'm placing the hole on the image and move it around and see what value it could be that I'm looking at. And you can see as I'm moving whether it's darker or lighter, and that's going to give me a really good idea how dark or light to make my mixtures. So I hope you find this useful, and if you have any questions creating your own value checker, just let me know.